Conversation is a senior lawyer practicing in the area of constitutional law, criminal law, and family law. She has worked extensively in cases relating to discrimination, custodial violence, prisoners, juvenile children, sexual harassment, the rights of minorities, and the rights of persons living with HIV/AIDS. She has written in newspapers and journals on legal issues and is associated with many national campaigns on legislations relating to women and children. She is on the faculty at the Asian College for Journalism, Chennai, where she teaches a course on medical law and society, and has also been associated in training lawyers and judges in the Asia-Pacific region. She has been an Haynes Fellow in the University of Pittsburgh on comparative law. We have a great privilege in having you here, ma'am. Ms. Sudha Ramalingam is a practicing advocate in the Madras High Court and a recipient of advocacy fellowship from the Advocacy Institute, Washington, D.C. She is presently the managing trustee of Manonmani Trust, was the vice president of People's Union for Civil Liberties and legal cell member, Tamil Nadu Women's Commission. She worked for the Sri Lankan Tamil refugees and participated in the South Asian consultation of the UNHCR at Bangkok. Was part of fact-finding teams probing into the human rights violations, custodial rape or death, prison conditions, caste clashes, minority rights, Dalit issues, aqua farms, and other environmental issues. Has filed public interest litigations on several important issues such as prison reforms and human rights violations in police custody. Has been writing in English and Tamil dailies, journals on various socio-legal political issues. Presented several papers in various seminars and conferences, been part of several talk shows on socio-legal political issues in the radio and TV programs. Has been imparting legal training in legal literacy programs and conducted by government and non-governmental organizations and in schools, colleges, and other fora. Has been part of training programs for policemen, college, and school teachers, training them and sensitizing them on human rights and legal rights. Has been awarded Audi Ritz Icon Award 2013 and 10th JFW Award for 2018 for best social work among others. We're glad to have you here, Ms. Sudha Ramalingam. And I request our guests, Ms. Geeta Ramasation and Ms. Sudha Ramalingam, to kindly take the stage. Thank you. I request Ms. Geeta Ramasation to kindly start the session. Please, ma'am.
Good morning to everyone. And I first of all thank FIKI and MMA for having this conference, which I believe is really very important and is part of the ongoing process that is stipulated under the law, under the Act itself, to have workshops which I'm sure the participants can take it back to the other organizations and expand what has been discussed today. A lot of things maybe that I'm going to say, Sudha is going to say, and maybe the other speakers would say, could be a bit repetitive because we are talking about sexual harassment and what we understand of sexual harassment. And therefore, to some extent, Sudha and I thought that we need not really talk for 1 hour, maybe make the talk a little less and have much more interaction and questions from all of you. Be that as it may, I just want to begin by asking you certain examples or giving you certain questions as to what you think. There is a male employer, and I'm putting the query to all of you, There is a male employer who thinks that women cannot do the job allotted to them. Yeah? So he constantly says that you can't do this well because you're a woman. And as between you and your male colleague, he gives a preference to the male colleague. And I want to ask you, do you think that this is harassment? Yes. Who said yes? Okay. Yes and no are coming here. So can I have the responses of those who have said yes? Yeah. Could you say, why do you think that this is harassment? This is sexual harassment? It's emotional harassment. Okay. Any other responses on that? Yeah. Okay. Okay. Any other responses in that? Okay. There, yeah. Okay. Yes, sir. Then it amounts to harassment. Okay. Okay, workplace of course will have some kind of a bias. It's bound to happen. You, yes, ma'am. Okay. Any other responses? Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
It's definitely a gender discrimination. Example, media. Private pay spots only allotted for men in the ratios, for only for men.
Okay.
Example, journalism and journalism. Yeah.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. They'd rather have this. Yeah. Okay. So far so good, or if anybody else wants to say before I start. Right, so we find from this room itself a host of views that have emerged as to why we think that this could be harassment, or as to why we think that it is not harassment. Now, for the purposes of our law, this cannot be sexual harassment, but this is what one of the participants said here, discrimination on the basis of sex. Okay. Now, so here you find an employer, a boss or a colleague who thinks that women cannot do their jobs well, then that is a kind of discrimination, but the law as it stands today does not apply to situations of discrimination. And we do not, even though we have a constitutional right in the form of prohibition of discrimination, we do not have an equal opportunities law, which many other countries have, where a woman or a person can go and say, I have been discriminated against in this job because of the fact that I am a woman, or because I am a colored person, or because I am a particular caste, etc. Now, having said that, what you see in a situation of this nature is very different from what the Act actually envisages in the context of sexual harassment. Okay, I'm now going to give you another example. Let's say, you know, your male colleague says, why don't you come out for dinner with me? What do you think?
It might be a friendly
might be a friendly invite. What about others? You said can be a mutual trust. Repeatedly asking becomes sexual harassment. Depends upon
context.
Who decides and determines intention? Just an invitation. One of the comment was, if it is persistent, it amounts to harassment. That there is no problem with that. But when you say that a dinner invitation, depending upon her perspective, becomes harassment, we are looking at very complex relationships at the workspace. So let us assume that, you know, the woman does come from a background where an invitation is not accepted, or she is not aware of such acceptance. You know, like she comes from a very rural area, she's not been exposed, she's come now with the first job working in the IT sector, and her colleague says, let's go for dinner. Okay, her reaction to this situation could be very different from an urban woman who is probably exposed more and who can then say yes or no depending upon what she wants in that case. So at the workspace, you are also dealing with very complex understandings of what actually sexual harassment can be. And I'm giving you this example because this did occur in an organization where I am a member, where, of course, you know, this was the issue. So in the committee, we felt that it was not persistent. It was a one-time invitation, and when she said no, he did not pursue any further. So the finding that we gave was that this was not an instance of sexual harassment. But from her viewpoint, an invitation itself was a bit problematic in the context of how she reacted. Okay. Now I shall give you a third example, and I'm just giving you these examples before going into what actually the Act says. These are two people working in a company. They go abroad on work, and they stay in the same hotel, adjacent rooms, and the man tells her, let's have dinner together. She says okay, and they go to her room and they have dinner together. And she has her laptop open, and she has a particular picture of hers, you know, and then he looks at that picture and he makes a comment. Not a very savory comment. She then immediately asks him to get out of the room, and he gets out. Okay. The query that I want to ask you is that, is this a harassment in the workplace? What do you think? How do you say it is in the workplace, and how do you say it is not in the workplace? It's a notional extension of the workplace. What about those who said no? I mean, do you think it was not so because she invited him to her room? Yeah, so this is an advancement towards understanding the notion of workplace, unlike the traditional understanding of what a workspace means. Okay, so the company did feel that they have gone on work, and when they work from their rooms, and when they work from their rooms, that is a workspace. So it was taken on that score, and then therefore it was held that there amounted to be a sexual harassment. I am giving you these various examples because these examples are a sample of the kind of problems that you actually get in a workspace in terms of actually understanding what sexual harassment means. Now the law, of course, is very clear. The law talks about physical contact and advances. It talks about a demand or request for sexual favors. It talks about making sexually colored remarks. It talks about showing pornography. But it also says that harassment can include any other unwelcome physical, verbal, or non-verbal conduct of any sexual nature. Therefore, under this last clause that you see, because the first four are very specific, you know what exactly a woman can come before the committee with a particular kind of a complaint. But on the fifth, which is actually more complex in the way we understand sexual harassment or in the way the committee understands sexual harassment, you do find a lot of cases coming up in educational institutions, in companies where you have a huge young workforce which has different which has a different understanding of the nature of relationships, which has a different understanding of how far friendship should go, and where there is a situation in terms of this. So most often than not, there have been instances where, you know, they have had some kind of a friendship which has resulted in a little amount of a relationship, and then the relationship has stopped. Now, when there is a persistent behavior from the other person, what do you think? Do you think that that is harassment? It amounts to harassment. Yes, it does amount to harassment. Let me give you a reverse example. Supposing, for example, two people have been having a relationship. The relationship has stopped. The woman comes with a complaint of sexual harassment. What do you think? There is a consensual relationship, and then for whatever reason, the boy says, I can't date you anymore. What do you think? Consensual relationship outside the office, of course. They should move on. I agree. That's the best way of looking at it, actually. But what happens? Complaints do come on the score. So what do you think? I mean, how would you actually address such a kind of a complaint? The first example was fine. You know, if the man is persistent after the breakup, we say that that amounts to harassment, because the law is actually gender, it's not gender neutral. Yeah, it is gender specific. But what do you think of the other example? She gives a complaint. She's not chasing him. She says that we have had this relationship, and then he has now, taken advantage and broken off or whatever. And she gives a complaint saying that the previous instances all have amounted to sexual harassment because there is a breach of promise in this situation. It's a breach of trust, okay? But if there is, therefore she says, according to her, supposing she says, I have been cheated in this relationship. He promised me marriage, but now he's going to get married to somebody who is from his community, whatever. If it is not, all right. Do you think that this is an offense under the law?
Maybe an offense in different but under sexual harassment act, it won't come.
All right. Therefore, you feel that it does not come before the committee. Supposing somebody brings it to the committee, you may say that this is not sexual harassment. But let me take it further. Do you think that this is an offense? So then what is the role of the employer? How do you see the role of the employer under the act? All right.
Definitions are given in the sexual harassment act. There are five mistake which will constitute as a sexual harassment. It won't come with any of this. That is why it is done as sexual harassment.
All right. If you say, I agree if you say it is not sexual harassment for the purposes of the committee.
Yes.
Right. Do you as an employer have a role or have a duty under this act? Beg your pardon? Examine the facts. Obviously, a committee has to examine the facts. Committee, you see, any complaint that comes before you, you cannot throw it away straight away, right? You need to have an inquiry. In the inquiry, she makes this complaint. In the inquiry, the boy can come and say, this is what has happened. We had this relationship. We had this friendship, blah, blah, blah. Fine. You examine it. And you feel that there is a relationship. The earlier acts are not harassment under the law. There could be some cheating, she says, or she claims she has been cheated or harassed. As an employer, what do you think is your role under the act? Therefore, you will suggest her. Any other response? Any? So now, you know, it's interesting how the act actually positions itself. Okay. Under the act, you are, as an employer, there's a double contra provision, which can be a bit problematic. And I'll tell you how maybe some institutions are working towards it. Now, under the act, the employer is expected to provide assistance to the woman if she so chooses to file a complaint in related to the offense under the IPC or under any law in force. So when you, during the inquiry, feel that there is an offense or there are some facts, or at least what she says amounts to cheating, though personally I agree with you, I think you should move on and not go into this process. But since most people don't do that, an employer has to provide assistance to the woman if she chooses to file a complaint, which is fine. But the reverse of that, there is another provision following that under section 19, which is 19H. It talks of the employer shall cause to initiate action under the IPC or any other law for the time being in force against the perpetrator, or if the aggrieved woman so desires, where the perpetrator is not an employee, in the workplace at which the incident of sexual harassment took place. So we have all discussed this, we have felt that there is some bad drafting in this regard, where at one instance it says that the employer should provide assistance to the woman, but in the next breath it says that the employer must cause to initiate action. If you look at section 19, G and H, there is a contra. However, most women may just want an inquiry, may not want to go ahead, because what has actually happened is, and which in the morning Ms. Latika has spoken about, is that after this law has come into existence, you have had huge changes in criminal law in the IPC, where sexual harassment has been made a specific offense. There are other offenses of voyeurism, there are other offenses of stalking, etc., etc. Now, when this act was in existence, sexual harassment was not a standalone offense. Now, if you read both together, it looks as if the employer not just has to help the woman go to the police, he also has a duty to go and file a complaint. The section reads that way. However, not all employers are actually doing this. I may share this with you because it goes off in two ways. Now, there are many women who don't want to go to the police, who just want an internal inquiry when the act of sexual harassment is not very severe. Okay. In view of this, what do you think the employer can do? Right. Go to the police. Unfortunately, that's how the law is read. If the woman wants to go to the police, fine. There's no two opinion on that. You can easily help her to register a complaint.
But when it says that the employer himself has to initiate, you know, when it says that he has to cause to initiate action under the IPC, you have a, to my mind, my reading of this provision and law is that it is a contra provision, where even if the woman does not want to go to the police, the employer seems to have a duty-bound response to having to go to the police. What personally some organizations do in view of this provision is that if the woman is satisfied with the inquiry committee, they ask her whether she would still want to pursue it with the police. And if she says no, she doesn't want to go to the police at all, they take a written representation from her in this regard. So that, you know, when she is not interested in going to the police, and a lot of women don't want to go to the police. See, in, especially in the, when they are young, I have seen that in a couple of cases in the IT sector, where, you know, she doesn't even want her parents and family to know that she has given this complaint, because she is apprehensive that once this comes out, or if it comes out, they will stop her from going to work. Okay, so they just want that the harassment should stop, and that the management should take some kind of an action. Now, in such situations, if the employer says no, even if this is what the law says, let's go to the police, you will then have a scenario where women may not come forward and give complaints to the ICC. So, very specifically, I believe that the committee has a responsibility to tell the woman that in addition to the inquiry that is happening, if she is wanting to pursue the matter with the police, the employer or the management will be supportive of her actions. But if she does not want to go to the police, then she needs to give a representation stating that she wants only a committee inquiry and not a police case. I mean, this is a way in which some organizations try to harmonize these two provisions under the law. To my mind, the reading is that one particular clause has come away. There is a grammatical error which has resulted in this. But anyway, since that is the law, this is how one would actually need to take this forward. I just want to end on one more note and leave it to Sudha to start. And one is that the in committee requires that an inquiry must be based on the principles of natural justice. And that's a huge word. I mean, as lawyers, we know that there is huge amount of administrative law on what we understand as natural justice. But I would like to ask you, what do you think is natural justice? Other party, yeah? Right. Hear the other side, and no man should be a judge in his own cause. That's a legal word coming. That's a legal word, audi alteram partem, yes. And if the committee members are aware of that process, then you don't have a problem. If they are aware of audi alteram partem, then you don't have a problem. What about the others? Not unfair. Okay, so hearing both sides in a very neutral manner, giving them sufficient time to get ready with their case, asking them witnesses, and right now cross-examination is a very contentious issue, because the Act actually does not want it to be like a regular labor inquiry where you have, you know, examination and cross-examination. Many organizations don't do the cross-examination part in this way it is envisaged. So what they do is that when written complaint is given, the questions are asked to the person as to what are the kind of questions he or she would like to be put to the opposite side. And the committee puts those questions and records them. Well, that is the principle which is followed in many cases, even relating to child offences. where the judge actually puts the question and the courts don't allow the lawyers to cross-examine. You can have you can call the person again and ask for various clarifications, etc. Because sometimes if the woman says, I don't want to see him, I'm afraid of him, and I'm not interested in meeting him, and many women do say that, then you have to have a response in that regard. If she is, of course, willing to sit around and when he is asking her, then that's a different matter. But the questions has to be put, but it can be put through the committee members rather than through a direct cross-examination, like how it is done in other labor matters. So that's one principle that is followed in most ways. Now, internal? It has to come there, yes. We don't, okay, let me put it this way. Let's not use the word cross-examination because that's very legalistic and that is very frightening in some ways. What you necessarily have to do is the complaint is given to you, the counter response is given to you. Ask, the parties have to have the responses. It is a principle of natural justice that the respondent must know what the complaint is against him. And he must be given a chance to respond, and both of them can be required to bring in their own witnesses, etc. Now, when this happens, as the committee can easily ask either of them, what are the questions you would want me to put to the other side? So, the cross-examination, so to speak, I don't want to use the word cross-examination again, but the cross-examination, so to speak, is actually done by the committee. There has to be a double inquiry. See, that position under the Act is not very clear. And if you actually look at the disciplinary inquiry proceedings with the government or other establishments, the punishment is much more higher than what the Act recommends. The Act recommends, you know, which Sudha can talk about, much minor punishments. So that there is a, but everywhere it says, except where there is separate disciplinary rules. So there is still the position of that is unclear. To my mind, it is still very unclear, especially when they are government servants or, you know, when they are governed by other set of disciplinary rules. But private organizations come barely under this fora. Yeah. Disciplinary rule under the bank. So in a way, you might end up having a double inquiry, or take this report itself as a basis. However, you will have a situation where the respondent will take up this on appeal also, maybe take it, challenge the finding, but you can still use that as a mechanism. But the double inquiry, we have discussed this a lot. The Act is not very clear about how the double inquiry process works. I think Sudha can throw more light on that. Yeah. Yes. No audio poltrum, and then the reverse is the lawyers who made a fuss about that are facing CBI charges against them and raids. Well, I also want to add that as far as high courts are concerned, forget the Supreme Court. There the charge was leveled at a very high place. There are cases of harassment leveled against various high court judges.
where they have then come around and said they will form their own rules. That is the judgment of Rajasthan, that has been the judgment in Madras, that has been the position in other places. They are a law unto themselves, what to do? Latest judgment of the Delhi High Court, which was reported last week, I think, has said that has directed compensation to be paid. There is a provision under the law for that. No, malice is, if you see, there is, she'll talk about that. There is a provision under the law. So, yes, it is quasi-judicial. I don't know. See, why should there be a double inquiry? That position is very unclear. I agree with you that once this inquiry report comes, it is also going on the basis of principles of natural justice, and it arrives at a particular finding. But the concept of double inquiry is only with reference to government and other agencies which have their own set of rules in terms of disciplinary processes. I think that is still private organizations, private organizations today, anyway, you are now going to have all the existing labor laws being weakened. So private organizations today will just hire and fire. So there's no even government is going to do that. So there's no difference on that score. But be that as it may, I just want to end now and leave it to Sudha to say that complex situations arise in terms of sexual harassment, but the harassment is often quite real for many women. As Ms. Latika said in the morning, sexual harassment is considered to be a issue that affects health, and all women or any women, most women who have been, the issue is, if I were to ask you, have you faced any kind of a harassment? Every woman would say at some point of time in their lives, they have faced harassment. So all women face harassment and not all men are harassers. So on that, the problem is very real for women in terms of how they react and respond. More and more young people have different concerns that emerge in the way they use, smartphones, the way they communicate with each other. And so various scenarios actually emerge in an office space which needs to be handled sensitively by the committee. So I thank you all once again for giving me this opportunity.
Good morning to one and all. Geeta has actually covered a lot of things, and earlier on Mrs. Latika Charan also spoken quite elaborately. I would like to take on from what Geeta said. As such, we were all talking about this double jeopardy-like thing, where there's going to be two inquiries. What happens is I'm part of the ICC as an external member in one of the public sector undertakings in Tamil Nadu, rather in India. And here we found an officer guilty of sexual harassment. And the ICC gave a finding that the officer is guilty. And we said, we left it, of course, to the employer to take action as per their service law. So now what their service law says is that there will have to be another inquiry. The earlier inquiry was as per the Sexual Harassment Act, where the ICC conducted the inquiry, in which, of course, there was this entire process of natural justice which was done, and in which the woman and her witnesses were bold enough to say, we will take on and answer him directly itself. So he was allowed to cross-examine, but there was no person helping him or her. Both of them faced the inquiry committee by themselves without any other assistance as any defense counsel or the prosecuting person. So now what has happened is, as per their service law, there should be a presenting officer on the side of the employer, and there will be a defense counsel for him. So he is left to have a defense person to help him. From among his, he has now found out a person who is a retired employee who is conversant with law itself, and now it's going on, of course. So this particular inquiry now takes on. He now fortunately accepted that part of the evidence which was taken there earlier, the depositions, could be taken along with this in this also, and there will be no chief examination as such. Whatever was provided earlier would be the chief, and then he will come up with his counsel to cross-examine these witnesses. So the entire process of inquiries like this are definitely overlapping each other, more so when you also go parallelly file a police complaint. Then there is another, in this particular case which I'm talking about, there is a complaint, an FIR registered by the police, and there is another proceeding also going on in the criminal courts. So there will be, now it becomes three different inquiries for the same offense. So these are things which are, I think, in a teething period of any act which has come into force. It will be there. It takes a little time for us to also find out how we are going to weed out all these things. But having said that, what I would like to add and state is that as far as this particular act itself is concerned, there is a real challenge that it's all sort of a decentralized act. The act gives powers not to any statutory authority, but it gives the employer the choice to have to form an ICC, or as far as the districts are concerned, of course, it is all people who are in unorganized sectors. The district magistrate or the any person selected by the state district authorities will form what is called the local complaints committee. So that's one aspect which we are not going to deal with, because here this is all organized sector. So as far as these organized sectors are concerned, what we find is this decentralized mechanism itself blows hot and cold quite a number of times. Whenever there is a complaint, the complainant is seen as a nuisance by the HR. I'm sorry to tell this. Yes, this is what I see most often than not. They don't see her as a victim. The first reaction is, there's so many other women working here, why only this woman is coming out with this complaint? So she is too reluctant to come out with a complaint at all. And especially now after this Me Too movement, Gita and me were speaking about it, we also find a lot of things being exposed about harassments which happened several years back also. And how is it going to be dealt with? As far as the act is concerned, the act would say you go and give a complaint within 3 months. But here are matters which would have happened about at least 5 years back and all. Are we going to take this complaint or not? Of course, the act itself says if you want, you can also extend this there. And you need not be sticking to this rule of three months. So everything is a little ambiguous as far as the act is concerned. And the efficacy of the entire act itself is only in as far as how the ICC really acts. Because there are instances where the ICC in certain organizations takes up complaints very, very seriously, helps the victim, and ensures that the respondent gets adequate punishment and the victim is compensated. But most often they're not. What they try to do is, one, either they ask the complainant to keep quiet, or they call the respondent and say, here there's a complaint against you, better resign and go away, otherwise there will be a black mark in your service register, and this will also reflect in your further employment processes. So he'd also be very willing to get away from this entire scene. So there is a full stop to it, but definitely it is not a full stop to a harasser. The harasser may go and continue this harassment elsewhere, very coolly, because he has actually got away, and the victim also really does not feel any redressal at all. So this is something which is happening very, very often, and there are also instances where the perpetrator is asked to go to some other place and the management forgets it or makes the victim forget it. This is something which is happening really routinely, and as Geeta also was pointing out when she was talking, the problem of getting punishment itself. When any person who is accused of sexual harassment is found to be really guilty and the management wants to really punish him, the question of what happens to not only him but to his family crops up a lot. In another public sector undertaking, wherein I was also assisting, I was the ICC member. You know, what happened was, we found that this man was definitely guilty of sexual harassment. He has even caused physical violence on her by hitting her also on the road when she was driving. He comes down, he pulls her out, and all sorts of, she's been, actually, her modesty was outraged, and there was also witnesses to tell this. You know, what happens is, during the course of the inquiry, he is transferred from his section to another section, which was actually nearer this woman's section. The management was nearly not even aware of all these things. It was a very, very big concern. So that was one thing. And secondly, when everything, at the end of the inquiry, it was found that this man was repeating this several times, and so he has got to be removed from service at all. Including the chairman of the ICC calls this victim woman and says, see, he has 3 children, he has a wife, if he is thrown out of job, what happens? So she is made to feel more guilty than even the respondent, the accused himself. He, despite finding out that he is a perpetrator and he continues to be, would continue to be one if he is not terminated from service. So this is the sort of guilt feeling that we give to women who gather the courage to prefer complaints. So what we also see is the composition of the ICC is therefore very, very, very important. In quite a number of instances, management, of course, has got to pick and choose the senior most woman officer. They don't find a senior most woman officer, first of all, who could be the chairing the ICC. That is, of course, the fault of the organization itself. So it is high time people, every organization finds also women occupying seats, which would actually also help them to deal with such instances. And the ICC will have to have, the chairperson will be the senior most woman officer, then 2 more officers at least from the company, and 1 external member who would be either a legal person or from any other social organizations where should be conversant with women's issues. You could have more number of members also. There's no limit with this, but these 4 are definitely important. 1 chairperson, 2 more members, and 1 external committee member. These are the mandated ones, but generally all organizations have more than 5-6 people at least in these organizations, and the composition would be such that more than 50 there should be a presiding officer shall be a woman, and also more than 50% of the members should be women. This is what it says. But I would also like to add and state that I am definitely, Geeta would agree with me, that this law, which is not gender neutral, is definitely, as quite a number of you would say, is also being abused, of course. That's what the question that you people put up now talks about. If the complaint is made with malice and is proved to be done with malice, then you can definitely punish her also. But if it is not with malice, if she could not prove a complaint, that does not mean that it is a complaint. That doesn't mean that the complainant should be punished as such. So it is not as if there is no way of taking any action against a woman who prefers a complaint which is false. But definitely the malice should be proved. It should be shown that it was definitely done for other reasons, not because there was, because she had other prejudices. And I also think that what is very important about this act is that the act also talks about publicizing the entire composition of the ICC itself, and also you should have, every company should also have a sexual harassment policy. I think that's very, very important, unless you also publicize about the existence of the ICC, and also you have a policy, and also tell the people that we are here to handhold with you and give you all the support. Women are not going to come out and give any complaint. In quite a number of institutions, whether it's very big or small, I found that many people in the organization, were very well placed in the organization also, do not know the existence of ICC or about the members in the ICC. So I would like to appeal to each one of you that if in your organization's website, kindly put up the information on the constitution of ICC and how you are going to deal with any complaint in the ICC and who are the members of the ICC, how do you contact them, their email ID and their phone numbers. These are some things which are very, very essential, because knowledge is power, and I find that lot of people in most organizations, however very well placed they are, I've seen even in among the media, chief reporter not knowing that there was an ICC in their organization. So this is how it goes. So ignorance about the existence of ICC is very, very rampant. I'm definite. I do not know who the ICC members of the High Court are. You also don't know. Adi, you know? But High Court, I was asking about it. See, we are also ignorant. So this is how the system works. But we are also not very transparent.
It doesn't convene, ma'am. It's only once or twice in a year. We do convene after.
And we are also very happy to say that there is no complaint. I'm definite that most places there are complaints, but the complainants are silenced. And I feel that most organizations take it upon themselves to silence any complainant only because they feel a complaint of a nature of sexual harassment is taken to be as if the institution has committed the crime. It's not so. It's one erring employee who has committed the crime, and you'll have to ensure that the other employee is given all the help possible. But quite a number of times I see that the organization wants to silence only because they feel that the bad name is going to come upon them. And this is one thing which is prevalent when in not merely sexual harassment cases, but even in other matters. Whenever there is some small wrong committed by any institution, when we try to point it out, they go to the defensive, and also they try to show off that there is no wrong has been committed there. Then there'll be no question of introspection, there'll be no question of also helping victims. So that's where I think we'll have to be thinking about reaching out to victims without feeling that we will be also targeted, that the names of the organization will definitely not go down by helping such victims. And such complaints are not in the public fora, of course. So if only you can show that there is a zero tolerance level in your company, in your concern, then the women will be empowered to come and speak out. The zero tolerance level should be shown to be your policy to the victim, not to say that there will be a zero tolerance only to show that there is no complaint law. Zero complaint is not what you should aspire for. It is zero tolerance which you should aspire for. That's what I really feel. And as far as the component of ICC is concerned, every now and then, repeatedly I say, the cost of repetition, that people really do not know the existence of ICC, about which I think the management has to think about it two or three times, and the ICC will have to submit its report every annually to the management, and the management will also take cognizance of it and act upon whatever the recommendations of the ICC is. This is the duty of the management also, especially with more and more and more women coming to working women coming out. of the houses, it's important that you start listening to them. Listening to them and acting proactively for their welfare is something which is very, very important. And as far as HR is concerned, kindly, kindly don't think that complainants are nuisance. This, I'm repeating this because every time I find, wherever it is, even in our courts, if we start raising our voice, we are seen as a nuisance only. But raising voice is very important to fight for justice, is it not?
Madam, what about the local committee?
The local committee is for unorganized sector. It's almost on the same similar parlance of the ICC itself. In the districts, you know, the local committees are formed in the districts by the district magistrate or the district collector, and that will also have similar members and people like, you know, an agriculturist, a mason, domestic worker, they can go and prefer a complaint there to the local committee, and the local committee will conduct inquiry. There they are assisted by the local committee people itself. And if the local committee comes to a conclusion that the respondent has committed the offence, then they can recommend for and any punishment. And if it is going to be a fine, if that could for compensation, that could be recovered like revenue recovery proceedings by the tahsildar from the respondent and given to the victim. That is different. SCST representation is.
Yes, it is there. From the local committee.
Seven of them, I think. Okay, I'm sorry, I left it out. Yeah. The constitution of this is every district officer shall constitute a district in the district concerned a committee to be known as local committee to receive complaints of sexual harassment from establishments where the internal committee has not been constituted due to having less than 10 workers, or if the complaint is against the employer himself. The district officer shall designate one nodal officer in every block, taluka and tehsil in rural or tribal area, and ward or municipality in the urban area to receive complaints and forward the same to the concerned local committee within a period of 7 days. Then the jurisdiction of the local committee shall extend to the areas of the district where it is constituted. As far as the composition is concerned, a chairperson is to be nominated amongst the eminent women in the field of social worker and committed to the cause of women. One member to be nominated from amongst women working in the block, taluka or tehsil. Two members of whom at least one shall be a woman to be nominated from amongst the non-governmental organizations or associations committed to the cause of women, or a person familiar with the issues relating to sexual harassment which is prescribed, provided that at least one of the nominees should preferably have a background in law or legal knowledge. The next proviso is what you are talking about. Provided further that at least one of the nominees shall be a woman belonging to the scheduled castes or scheduled tribes or other backward classes or minority community notified by the central government from time to time. The concerned officer dealing with the social welfare or women and child development in the district shall be a member ex officio. So the chairperson and every member of the local committee shall hold office for such period not exceeding 3 years. There also it's only 3 years. Ten members. Yes.
This local committee will be playing a role.
Yes.
Of IC.
Yes.
That is why I asked.
You are right, right. Yeah. So it's almost same, only parallel.
No,
yeah.
There is some provisions they given. Welfare department person should be the nodal person.
Yeah. Yes. That's even as far as ICC is concerned, they say it's the senior most woman. Here is the nodal persons. And then, of course, the representatives who have got some legal knowledge or who have been working with women, here also it is the same.
Yeah, that is why they want to give you a section.
Yeah, it's more because you find that in the unorganized sector, you'll have more number of backward people from SC, ST people, STs in those areas where tribal areas are there. And of course, in other areas also, you find a lot of BC, MBC and SC people working in the unorganized sector.
Okay, I see you report. I want to go for an appeal. How it will be?
There is a provision for appeal in this. There is a provision for appeal in this itself. The Act itself speaks about an appeal provision. Rules 11. I don't have the rules here. Any person aggrieved from the recommendations are made under section 2 of the section, all these things, for now. The appeal shall be done within 90 days. Appellant yaar varanga? Actually, as far as the appeal is concerned, the appeal is under given in the section itself. They go to the labor court for appeals. In quite a number of these public sectors, because we recommend and ask the management to take action under their service laws, what they do is they start agitating before their personnel officers, and there's a committee formed there also, their disciplinary committee. That disciplinary committee itself works like an appellate authority as far as public sectors are concerned. As far as private organizations are concerned, they'll have to go to the labor court.
If they don't have an appeal within the management.
Yeah, if there is no appeal provision within the management itself. So I think every company should now start formulating a policy wherein you will have to work out on the modalities of hearing the not merely the ICC, also provision for an appeal.
Madam, we have a peculiar problem. We formed a committee. Considering the size of the organization, we had 8 to 10 people in the committee. Okay, equal representation, all the norms followed. But finally, when it came, it was told that all the committee members should be present for an inquiry. So keeping 10 people and asking an aggrieved woman to talk about that, it seems to be very...
You don't need to have everyone. No? You for every complaint when you call them, you restrict it to say 4 or 5 persons only. Then have it before the 5 persons.
So all the committee members need not be there.
No, you need not. If you have a larger committee, the committee could have the chairperson and one external member. Will be the, yes. Yes. Yeah. 4 from them will do. Chairman, external committee member, and 2 more will do.
I'll intervene you, ma'am. Thank you. As per law, it's 4. 4 doesn't mean that only 4 should be there in any committee. According to the strength of the organization, you can have more. But when you convene a meeting or when you convene for an inquiry, the chairwoman's presence is necessary, and also the external member. Some committees, when they convene, they don't have the external member, then it will be against the legal thing, and that inquiry may not turn out to be the, and the eye of law, it will be not acceptable. So law says 4. 4 we can take it as minimum. There is one organization, it's an hospital, where 11 members from each department is put in. But 6 or 7, the majority will be there. So chairwoman's presence, in her absence, she can depute anyone that can be recorded. So as madam told, it's correct. Minimum is 4. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
The minimum is 4, and sometimes if you can't get everybody together, now you have the video conferencing options, no? Bring them through the video conference. That's always there. What else? Then, you know, this act also, what I think we forgot is, speaks about conciliation first. So when there is a complaint given, the first step is to ask the parties, give the other party the copy of the complaint, and then ask both the complainant whether complainant is a victim, whether she is willing to for a conciliation. So in case the other party says sorry, whatever explanation he gives for the particular situations that is spoken about, and she is satisfied with that explanation, then there could be a full stop to the entire proceedings.
Okay, conciliation will be done by
the ICC. The ICC. The HR can also do it, but the ICC inquiry itself, the first step is conciliation.
The HR can do it, or the committee can do it, but if she's not willing for a conciliation, then it is.
Yeah, then it goes to the inquiry. You have to reduce a complaint to writing, otherwise it could be an oral complaint, but you have to reduce it to writing, because you have to give it to the other side, no? And ask him for his response.
Yeah, it's working. Ma'am, so is there any personal liability of directors of a company in case of sexual
personal
harassment?
Liability for somebody, it can't be vicarious. Liabilities, you know, you cannot punish a person vicariously for what somebody else does.
Yeah. Sure.
And this is an offense which is really personal in nature. It is not something which you say the company has committed for the...
What about the instance where the company's culture promotes something?
Companies?
The company's culture promotes something like that. If they say things like, when I, a lot of companies have that sort of boys club sort of mentality, where to join senior management, you need to go out and do things and fraternize with, senior management people.
Geeta beautifully started out itself with various examples, is it not? Where you could call somebody for your dinner, or where you go and stay with in the adjacent rooms or whatever it is. Hmm. Even Latika Charan, I think, was speaking about the one instance of the employer asking her to share the room or whatever it is. So these are instances of whether you have a boys club, girls club or whatever, mixed club or separate clubs, that's not going to be concerned. But you cannot pass any comment would definitely not be welcomed by the woman.
No, I'm
this
not...
is the basic funda.
Sure, I'm just saying, would directors or senior management have any responsibility if the perpetrator claims that he committed sexual harassment because of the culture of the place?
Unless you show that he really abetted the crime, I don't think he will be responsible.
No, I mean, okay, there is something conflict of interest. If you tell the woman that unless she socializes, she cannot be promoted, that is a form of harassment under the Act.
Right.
Okay. Socialize is a loose word. I mean, that's not the right word. But if you say that unless you come out with me, or unless you yield to what I'm asking, you cannot be promoted, that is a form of harassment under the Act.
Hmm.
But if you're saying that the company has a culture, okay, like in ad agencies or in so many other places, if they work late, they drink, they use all kinds of words, I don't think we have reached the stage where we can say that that ambience is harassment. If that is what you're saying.
Yeah, that is what I was referring to.
Ambience is harassment.
It would create like a toxic environment.
We are now also losing our sense of humor when we start talking about this in a very, very strict form. Definitely, we'll have to also learn to draw a line where it is acceptable, where it is not acceptable. But that is very, very personal. What is right for you or what I can accept may not be what another person will accept. As Geeta rightly put it, if the person is coming from a very rural background, from a place where she has not interacted with any other opposite sex, the same sentence, same way of talking may be received very differently by another person. So you have got to ensure and see that the woman is not uncomfortable with such gestures, words or exchanges. That's more important. You can't have I don't think there is any culture as such for any intermingling in any organization, or even for that matter, even at homes.
Madam, repeatedly the question was coming whether the director is responsible, management is responsible. They may be responsible for not complying with the provisions of the Act, not for somebody's act.
That's why I said there is no vicarious liability.
Yes. Yes.
But where the top management, like the managing director or chairman or somebody, has misbehaved, there have been cases when damages have been filed against the company also.
Can you quote a case, madam? Any case law on this?
I don't want to say the names of companies. Maybe in private we can discuss.
Okay. Is there any time limit from the complaint when the inquiry to be completed?
No, 3 months. It says 3 months, but it's always extended.
Whether it can be extended, whether there is a provision for that.
The law says 3 months, but generally it gets extended. And courts also don't stick to their time frame and limitations. So they also have lost their...
Okay, often they are quoting the Visakha case. What is meant by Visakha case?
Visakha case is the first case with which that was a public interest litigation where a woman was harassed in Rajasthan because she was taking up cases against the high caste people and taking on them. She was actually raped by a number of people. It was an assault on her individuality, on herself, because she was actually a reformer, a social worker in her area, Banwari, no?
Yeah,
So what happened is, this matter was taken up because it happened, she was taken to task and raped because she was working.
And
she was helping the victims.
She
was stopping child marriages in the area. So the caste Hindus took it upon themselves to teach her a lesson. So what happens is, this is taken up as a class litigation up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court says there is no law as on date as far as protecting women at workplaces are concerned. So they come out with a series of guidelines wherein they say that every concern which employs women should have a complaint committee and take up issues and help her. So that they also framed these rules because they said, they suggested that the central government should legislate a law, but they also knew that central government is not going to legislate immediately. So during the interim period, to ensure that women at workplaces are given protection, they give a series of guidelines on the basis of which is this act enacted.
Okay.
It took nearly more than 10 years for enacting this act between the period. Visakha was which year?
97.
And this, yeah.
Madam, just an observation. I think the whole act, the whole thing looks to be pretty one-sided and gender biased. And it looks at with the balancing act is required. It looks at with the preconceived notion that all women in general are innocent and victims, and all men are projected as villains. Now, what if there is a situation, a lady woman officer harasses a junior male staff,
even
and then if he goes and complains, will it be taken up?
Yeah, this is something which is crops up almost everywhere. You know, wherever there is, you can use a knife to cut vegetables as well as to kill a person. You can use fire to destroy this entire building and also use it for cooking and other purposes. So likewise, every law could be abused and used. What do you think about 138 of Negotiable Instruments Act? All of you think that if it's a check bounce case, there's such a good law, we are able to go and present a case before the magistrate and get the money back and also put this fellow behind the bars. How many check bounce cases are false cases, do you know? Are we even murmuring and muttering about it? We do not. Because it is commerce, because it is money, you don't mind any transgression, you don't mind any misuse, any abuse. When it comes to women, you always start talking about imbalances. There is imbalance in monetary situations. Are we talking about it? Everything can be abused.
Can I add something to that?
Not only that, if there is a harassment for man, he can opt for general laws. These are special laws given because it is seen, understood, and history shows that women are the harassed. And Gita very clearly said, not all men are harassers, but all women have been harassed at one point of time or the other.
Can
that
I just
is why
add
we
to
need
that?
These new law, these special laws.
Can I just add to that? See, educational institutions do have instances of harassment between men. Okay? We know, in terms of homosexual behavior, they do get complaints of men harassing other men. And they have formulated their own rules to deal with this. So, this is a specific law to be dealt with by the establishment. But as Sudha says, if you have come across an instance of a senior woman officer harassing a man, I think you are well within your rights to take any kind of a departmental action, or as well as report it to the police under the law.
Question?
Yeah, please ask.
Question on the minimum number of members to constitute. We were talking about number of we were the number of cases where you need to take a vote, right? So they always advise that the minimum number. Be odd. So if it's 3, 5, 7, because tomorrow if you
have. This is the 4 minimum is given by the Act. The management can have more than 4 people. That's no problem at all. That's what odd even is up to the management. The Act speaks about at least minimum, that's one chairperson and 2 from your organization itself and 1 external member, 4 members. If the organization so decides, it can have 5, it can have 7, it can have 9, it can have n number of persons. This is not to put a vote, yeah, it's more of an inquiry. When there is a disagreement, you can always have another person included. She wanted to speak.
So I just have an observation, like to add to what he said. When last year when Me Too was very strongly spoken about, and especially on Twitter, lot of men surprisingly came up and they opened up about their whether they were being harassed at work or family. Yes, Posh is about being gender. It's not gender neutral, though you all have spoken that a man can also approach, complain, and action can be taken. But yes, women have been harassed, most of them have faced harassment, but men also face harassment that we've seen. Second is when we spoke about ad agencies, media, you spoke about it and one of them spoke. After Me Too, when last year it was very much into limelight is not the right word, sorry. Most of them in ad agencies, media, especially men, have been scared. They don't know how to deal with it. How to speak, because the environment, work environment can be so free and conversations happen where they tease each other. They really don't know how to deal with it, what to speak, how to speak with their women counterparts. So that's an observation and how.
See, that's how I have known of a person who has lost his job from an ad agency, where the question that he had asked was, not a made-out case, but he lost his job. The fact is that the Act does not just look at the inquiry process. It looks at educating the idea of gender. The idea of gender relations, and we need to understand that issues of sexuality, sexual harassment and sexual violence are 3 different things. Yeah, we don't have much understanding of that, and everything overlaps in the Indian context. So essentially the Act then says that the employer is obliged to have workshops, to have constant discussions with everybody on this, and that is where I think these questions need to be asked and raised.
See, whenever you talk about laws pertaining to women, we also start talking about gender neutral laws. This is not, we have not reached a stage where women does not need special laws.
We are still at a stage where women need special laws to help her to come out. We are still in a stage where women are not encouraged to take up many professions, not even to go to good schools. If it's your finance doesn't permit, only the boys in the sons in the family will be given better education. We are still in a stage where women needs that helping hand, you know. So we need these special laws. You talk about any domestic violence act, you talk about any other laws pertaining to even matrimonial laws. Now we have the Save Indian Family, which comes and says, has also quite a number of women among them. Likewise, after Me Too, there's also some men also have gone about talking about men too, us too, or whatever it is. So these are things which would inevitably be there. In fact, Geeta, me, Adi, all of us are also assisting men in some of the cases when we think that they are harassed.
Madam, whether that aggrieved person should give the complaint, or by seeing her getting harassed, her friend or head of the department can give that complaint?
The others can also prefer a complaint, but the complainant will have to actually stay, also speak about her harassment, otherwise there will be no proper evidence to prove it. But initiating a complaint, even others can initiate a complaint.
I want to go back to the harassment of men, because inevitably, now see, supposing in your office one employee commits theft, you're going to take immediate action in that, right? So nothing would prevent the employer from taking any action on any kind of harassment. Let's make it clear. But when it comes to women, there is a specific act which lays down a specific procedure in that regard as to how this process can be done. Educational institutions, as I told you, have set up their own committees to deal with harassment of men by men, which can be high in college institutions.
Madam, I appreciate the way you were fiercely defending this Women's Centric Act.
Yes.
My question is, has it sorted out all the issues in this country?
There's no panacea for everything.
Okay. How many companies still push their issues like this under the carpet, and how many companies have the guts to come out with this lady was offended? Can you please tell me some
examples? That's why when I started itself, I said how the management generally tries to feel when there is a complaint itself preferred. The complainant is one, a nuisance. Secondly, they would like to call the respondent and say there is a complaint against you, better quit and go away. You will otherwise have this in your service records and it will reflect in your CV always. So these are things with which the company tries to show that there is no complaint. They are very happy that there is no complaint. That's why I told you, let us not have be proud of the fact that there is no complaint. There is no zero complaint is not what we should be proud of. We should be proud of being zero. We should be zero tolerant, you know. We should not be tolerant of any person who is going to be a victim, be a perpetrator. Be helpful to the victim. So be zero tolerance level is what we expect from every management. But that doesn't mean that like the police bringing out the prohibition offences cases, for the sake of the numbers, they would, at the end of the year, they would go and file false cases against some of these constant prohibition offenders. Don't do it for the sake of statistics.
My respect to my seniors on the dais. When issue of women comes up, everywhere the men do raise up. Just think for a moment, don't think of the women all in the audience. Think of your mother, think of your sister, think of your beautiful wives, your girlfriends, above all your lovely daughters. It's not women as such, outside women. Just when we women speak, the women in this auditorium or in the dais, we have all the women who have come out. There are lots and lots of women outside the world who cannot even utter inside their own home. There are domestic violence happening. We are not pinpointing out all the men are the offenders. I am the daughter, I have a father. I am a wife, I have a husband, I am a mother, and I have a son. So we are not pinpointing out the people. Oru paana paalla oru thuli vesham mari We request all the gentlemen brothers in the audience to join the hands of the women who are suffering. We are not pinpointing out any one of you. And many of you know me personally here in this audience. That's why I'm here with you all. It's not accusing each one gender that you are this way or other way. I've come so far because of the support of the men in my own family, my own profession here. It's somewhere women are not able to voice out. And Madam, Sudha Madam, when you put a question of this sort, she'll be the first person to come like that. It's not only Sudha Madam's voice. It's voice of the people who are voiceless. Who are literally voiceless, who cannot speak out. Each and every woman, including Adi Lakshmi here, at least once in our lifetime, we would have faced harassment in a form of e-teasing. There are women who have faced plenty and they do not speak out. This law, when you take off a law, they will go into the ratio of the offenses committed and they will bring about a special law. And this is because of an international convention of CEDA, you get off all these special laws after 93. After 93 of ratifying CEDA only, India has got many laws. And even now, we get many of the paper orders only. Look at the maintenance order we get in 125. All the lawyers here, we get 125 order on paper. Not literally we will help out. How many cases of sexual harassment is being wept under the carpet? They don't even bring it out. They don't even voice out. Just instead of saying women, I assure you all men, when I become the law minister of this country, I make this law gender neutral, or I will bring a special law for the men who are affected here, if at all you are truly affected. Thank you.
Actually, I want to add, we don't want this forum men versus women actually. We organize the event to make the people very sensitive. If you know the data, still the 48, recent as a couple of months back, 48% of the women still feel they are sexually harassed in the workplace actually. Of which 72% still don't complain actually. We wanted every woman to really be sensitive, rise up to your rights and be stand up to what your rights are actually. Now we don't want a forum as it goes, men versus women. Sorry, that's not our intention of organizing the event actually. The event is being organized to make you sensitive, both women and men, to the issue what we have in hand actually. We have an issue. If the issue is not there, there won't be an act. If the act is not there, they won't be implemented. Idea is, women, please come forward and take the men on. Rather than cribbing, no, men are very bad. No, men are not bad. If you tell them, they will listen. Similarly, women are also not bad. That's the idea. I thought I'll share with you the data. 68% of you don't come forward. Raise the issue, madam. Over to you, madam.
Yeah, don't subvert the mechanism. That's what I would like to end up with. Definitely.
Does the act require the entire process to be kept confidential?
Yes. If it's not kept confidential, you're also subjected to penalty. I would like to appeal to all of you, don't subvert the mechanism. We have a beautiful law in its place. If there is no harassment, we are not going to use this law. Why should anyone be afraid of this law? People who are perpetrators only would be afraid of this law. Thank you.
We are having a senior lawyers. Anybody, because we want to make this law to be understood properly, awareness should be more. Any question is there, you can ask. This is a best chance to have a two senior High Court lawyers on the dais. And third one is sitting in the audience.
Madam, I have a suppose. Lawyers can give me the answer. Suppose in the finalization of the entire proceedings, the chairperson, the presiding officer, has some kind of a recommendation, and if one of the ICC member, the internal committee member, has certain different perspective and recommendation, and it's having differing opinion. So how do we deal about it and how do we present to the management?
See, Sudha can also add to that. See, my way of understanding is you're talking of a majority opinion and a minority opinion, right? I think both the opinions need to be presented to the management and then leave it for the management to decide on the course of action. Would be one way.
Coming from the Tamil media, மீடியாவை பொறுத்த பிரிண்ட் ஆர் விஷுவல் விஷா பெரிய லெவலில் இல்லை. எங்கள் மீடியாவில் வந்து விஷாகா கமிட்டி ஃபார்ம் பண்ணியிருக்கோம். நான் ரெண்டு கேஸ் ஸ்டடீஸுக்குள்ளே எக்ஸ்ஆர்ஒய்யாக வச்சு தான் சொல்கிறேன், பட் எனக்கு அதுலேருந்து கிடைக்க வேண்டிய சொல்யூஷனுக்காக உங்ககிட்ட கேட்குறேன். விஷுவல் மீடியாவில் ஒரு கேஸ், ரொம்ப பாப்புலரான கேஸ், ஒரு ஜெயிண்ட் எடிட்டர் மேலே கம்ப்ளைண்ட், அவர் ஹைகோர்ட் தலையிட்டு அதுக்கப்புறம் அவருக்கு அரெஸ்ட், இப்போ பெயிலில் வெளியில் வந்தார். பட் விஷாகா கமிட்டி ஹைகோர்ட்டோட டைரக்ஷனில் அந்த மேனேஜ்மெண்ட்டில் அமைக்க சொல்லி அமைச்சாங்க. ஆனால் பட் அந்த எடிட்